Donc, c'est un plaisir aujourd'hui de recevoir Jean-Baptiste Fleury. Jean-Baptiste est un produit local, quelqu'un qui a fait toutes ses études à Strasbourg, détrompe-moi. En particulier, la licence, la maîtrise, le DEA de matière condensée, à l'époque sous la direction de Laurent Jalabert, de Rodolphe Jalabert. Il a fait en particulier son stage de DEA avec Hendrik Abou-Singo à l'Institut Charles Sadron, donc un institut que déjà finalement seule une minorité a le privilège de se souvenir, donc, qui était l'institut, le bâtiment avant que nous déménagions ici, c'est-à-dire en 2007. Une thèse sur les cristaux liquides avec le professeur Yves Galerne, qui nous fait l'honneur de venir écouter son ancien étudiant. Un postdoc sur la microfluidique au Max Planck de Göttingen, le Max Planck de dynamique des fluides, c'est ça, à Göttingen, pendant un petit nombre d'années, avant de devenir groupe leader à l'université de Saarbrücken, dans laquelle il se trouve encore. Et donc, c'est en tant que groupe leader à Saarbrücken qu'il vient nous présenter une partie des travaux de son équipe. Voilà, je te laisse la parole.
Merci. So thank you. It's always a pleasure to be here because Fabrice said it. Indeed, I made all my study here. I was my stage as a master student that was with Hendrik. That was on theory on crystallization of polymer, if I remember well. It was very interesting, but it was the other institute when we were in the Orangerie. So here, I will present a part of research that I do in my group, and it's a little outside what we do typically in my group. My group is doing biophysical studies, and the cornerstone that we use in my group, it's a microfluidic bilayer, as I will show you later. So it's an artificial system that mimics cell membrane. And we do it using microfluidic tools. And we study physical questions like membrane fusion, viral fusion. And one of the topics, or lipid droplet, which is a very hot topic in Germany now. And so most of my group is on this direction. But here I will show you a work based on microplastic. So it's a kind of new direction that we put. And this is with only me here in that case, and my colleague Vladimir Bolin, who is a theorist, a physicist who is working in the University of Tarragona. So me, I'm experimentalist, and Vladimir made the theory of this question. So what we want to study, it's the influence of microplastic with lipid membrane. So what is microplastic? What this field? It's huge. So microplastic, it's a tiny piece of plastic material, but as you know, we produce millions of tons of plastic every year, and they are dumped in the ocean by several ways. And in fact, in general, these plastics are pretty huge. At the beginning, they are millimeter size, even bigger. And due to the sun or where they're in the ocean, they spontaneously degrade in smaller pieces. And so they become smaller. So microplastic is when they are on the micron. And then with time, there is also some that become smaller. It's nanoplastic. I will not speak to it today. I will focus just on microplastic. And this microplastic, what they do after when they are in the ocean, they simply evaporate because they are very, very, very small. And they are redispersed along the earth due to the rain, along the city. They go to the soil. They are everywhere. And even we breathe them even continuously, as I will show you later. And for example, you can go to place where there is absolutely we should see absolutely zero micro or nanoplastic. As you see here, this little color, this is in fact plastic. This is a region where there is absolutely nothing. And in fact, we can see in Everest or other mountain far from everything, you can see trace of plastic that give artificial color like it. It's really not due to the sun. It's really plastic that are present somewhere. So the question why this field is huge, this field is huge because it interests a lot of different communities. It interests physicists, chemists, mathematicians, but people from climate, also people from oceanography, so marine scientists. So there is a huge community, huge trend, and the question is, what is the health consequence for microplastics? So what are they doing to us? So are they harmful or not? Are they dangerous? So what we know for sure is that if you have microplastic, you will not die directly. Otherwise, we will all be dead. But the question is, what is the long-term consequence? And or what are the consequences in long term? And this, it's a pretty unclear question. So this is, there is a tons of publication, and the press love it a lot. You can have a really the press impact. It's huge. Every month, right now, we found microplastic in nearly every organs. Even 1 month ago, people found microplastic in blood. They just took some people random in the street, some volunteers, and they analyzed the blood of people, and they found tiny microplastic into the blood. And in fact, microplastic has been found also in lung. I could have covered several slides just on the cover page, press cover page, showing organs where plastic are present. So they are there, and the question is, what are they doing? So if you speak to what is pretty clear, if you work on the level of living cell, is that microplastic creates very often inflammation due to oxidation. So this is pretty acknowledged by the community. If you speak to biologists or the medical community, they have many examples where there is living cell. And in this living cell, there is spontaneous inflammation and damage that are to the cell. So, but most of this damage are related to biological pathway or medical pathway. What do I mean with it? If you want biological pathway or chemical pathway, it's because you have triggered the plastic distort the chemical equilibrium around the cell. And due to that, it triggers a chemical reaction that creates an inflammation, so a spontaneous oxidation, for example. So what I mean is that microplastics are, in general, seen by the community, trigger inflammation that are all created by biochemical reaction or a protein that reacts strongly to that medical pathway, I would say. The question here that we want to address in this work is there also physical pathway? Is it possible that this microplastic do not only trigger inflammation of a living cell, but not by a pathway that are biological or involving chemical reaction, but really by pure physical process? And this is what the talk of today is around it. And this problematic, it's related to another problematic that we published recently, is that nano-objects that should be completely inert. So for example, here, gold particles that are completely inert and do nothing, for this example, are able to kill bacteria, even super-resisting bacteria, just by applying a mechanical stress on these bacteria. So what we want here, what we have seen is that objects that are completely inert and do not trigger any of this biochemical reaction that could kill a cell are able to kill a cell using by a mechanical process. So here, we just want to look if such type of effect also exists with microplastic. So first, so what type of physical effect particle can do to a bilayer and create an inflammation, a destabilization, or killing. But the most easy is to consider that it simply applies a mechanical stress. However, if you speak to a biologist, they will say it's not very interesting because in general, they think that only biological or chemical pathways are interesting to them. So they always disregard all, not all, but oftenly reviewer all, disregard completely the possibility that physical interaction, purely physical, exists. And the physicist, if you tell him, okay, I will put a particle on a bilayer or a living cell membrane, and this particle will apply the mechanical stress, he will tell you in general that in fact he don't mind so much about this stress because this lipid membrane is fluid, and as it is fluid, this stress should relax with time, which is a perfect, which is a good hypothesis. And so, basically, nothing is expected. But nevertheless, let's try one second to consider the case that is unlikely. But let's try to consider. I will put some microparticles made of plastic, so microplastic, and I will put them on a bilayer, and we want to see. And measure and calculate if they can apply the mechanical stress, because this mechanical stress will be similar to an inflammation, and what are the consequences on the membrane. So I start first with the theory of Vladimir. I hope I will not destroy it too much. So So in fact, Vladimir, what he used, it's a continuous model. So he, for him, the lipid bilayer, so this lipid membrane, it's a complete continuous 2D thin film. So we don't have molecule. We have something absolutely discrete molecule moving here. We just have a continuous membrane. And here we have our microplastic with a diameter, a certain diameter, and with a he applied a certain attractive interaction with this bilayer. So this is an effect due to absorption energy, attractive energy. Sorry, but it's this curvature, it's not due to weight or stuff like that. It's really absorption energy. So so here in this model, we suppose that this microplastic plastic can apply an attractive interaction with the bilayer, and this bilayer will start to be wrapped. However, we suppose this wrapping is low, so it's not a very important wrapping. And so it will just tiny bend and stretch the membrane here. So this we describe is described by the theory of Vladimir with a continuum mean field elastic model, so from the Helfrich Hamiltonian, where there is two parts, a part that is in fact the stretching and compressibility with the region A and B. So the B, it's the part of the membrane that is outside, far away, the microplastic, and the part A, that is the part that is in contact and that effectively feel the absorption energy. And there is a second term, which is the energy from this adhesion energy, so absorption density, absorption energy, and along this geometrical fraction. So we have an Hamiltonian, and we say that we want to go to the equilibrium. So the system will minimize its energy, and it will, in fact, numerically. So this is a simplified version of the last equation. And here, numerically, it solves alpha A and alpha B, which are the stretching locally on the region A and B. Alpha E, it's the stretching for an unperturbed membrane. So numerically, it solves all this equation, and you get how much for an attractive energy parameter. It solves all the membrane is stretched in this region A and B. And from that, we get this curve. So this is the bilayer stretching. So this is conceptually, we can simplify it in the following way. When a microplastic arrives to a lipid bilayer, it will consume a little part of this area of this lipid bilayer. Consuming this little part, it will induce a stretching.
Maybe you could define again alpha. What is alpha?
Ah, it's a local stretching. It's the local stretching, words. And it's defined from it's an additional parameter. It's defined by the geometry. It's the absorption density. It's an absorption density. Yeah. And but the main message is so we have a mean field elastic. We minimize it, and from that we see that for the membrane is stretching as a function of a number or surface fraction of particles. So more you put particles, more they consume area, more you stretch your bilayer. Okay, this is the qualitative, very ultra simplistic view. There is a region here, it's as a function of this parameter, which is in fact the only real parameter of the system, which is the interaction parameter, which is between the absorption energy per area and divide by the k, so that's the compressibility constant of the bilayer. And so this parameter tune the adhesive, the attractive interaction between the microplastic and the bilayer. And more is strong, of course, more the effect, so the consumption of area by a microplastic is strong, and more a bilayer is stretched. So here we have a region pure wrapping. So this is a region where the model is not well defined. Here it's for a bilayer without an initial tension. We have a bilayer that starts here and should be in zero, in fact, for zero. But the model diverges here. And in fact, more we put particle, more the tension of the membrane increases. And here we have the same, but done with a bilayer with an initial tension that is non-null, which is more realistic because you will see in experiments, we have a bilayer that is under tension. Yes? Sorry, you were speaking. Yeah. Now, here in this very simplistic model, indeed, you were speaking about, I missed the first. Now here it's only one. It's par. It's an energy par particule. I just put one. Okay, I'm not getting everything what you said, but maybe we can discuss that later. I mean, here it's a free energy par particule that is given. Of course, it's a model with a lot of simplification where we have basically only the elastic, so the stretching compressibility here, the energy of the stretching and the compressibility of the bilayer in the region A and B, and here it's the adhesion energy along the region A, and the energy that you get, it's due to the balance and the minimization between these two terms. So of course it's very simplistic. I'm not sure that I get the origin of the interaction that you mean, but okay. So basically what we get from this model is that the qualitative ID behind this model is to say that If I have a bilayer with a fixed area, if I put particle, this particle will consume, because it will stretch locally, this the local part around each particle, and this will create a tension because there will be there is area consumption simply. So what we see is that the tension expected on a bilayer in presence of microplastic, it's simply related to the surface covering times the compressibility. So basically, that say that more we put microplastic, more the tension of the membrane should be. So here it's for the modeling. Now I go to the experimental investigation. So what I will do, and this is my part. So what I will do, it's I will use microplastic. So microplastic, in reality, you see there are this object, but this it's a little larger than microplastic because in literature, this is a review as a particle in this range of size. So between half a micron and 10 micron. And bon, you see the shape of this plastic are quite complex. So for us, we will use, like in the theory, we will use something spherical to make the geometry much simpler. This is a simplification. And in the ocean, from people that have analyzed and collect plastic that were in the ocean, they have checked that this particle are typically made of four families that are, in fact, PS, so polystyrene, PE, propylene, and PA, polyacrylic. There is also PP as another family, but it's close to PE. So basically, we will use a microplastic that are sphere in this size, and also that are made of these three different materials. And for us, that will be our model version of microplastic. So the strategy experimentally will be the following. We will use a microfluidic chip. We will create a bilayer by a technique that I will show you. And this bilayer is freestanding. And I will disperse the microplastic. And then we will try to see if we can measure an increase of tension in presence of plastic particles. So to create our bilayer, I use a technique called droplet interface bilayer. That's a technique that was created in Oxford. And the idea, it's very simple. It's you have two water droplets in an oil bath. And in this oil bath, you disperse surfactant molecule, but here phospholipid. So these phospholipids have there's the basic block of an artificial membrane. So what they do, they have an hydrophilic head and a hydrophobic tail, as you know, and they self-assemble in a bilayer like that, composed of two monolayers. They do a structure like that, which is an artificial alter ego of a cell membrane, of course, more simplistic because here there is only lipid and not protein. But okay. So here we have two water droplets, and you put them in an oil. This is your solvent. And you disperse your lipid, phospholipid, into this oil. As due to their hydrophilic, hydrophobic composition, they will cover each water oil interface to create a lipid monolayer spontaneously. And if you put these two droplets together, you will create a bilayer just at their interface, just a matter of time. And you can see them optically. Even here, if it is vertical, it's not very great, you can see them. And you can put electrode and you can apply the electrophysiological measurement to really demonstrate that this bilayer is formed. So here we will do the same, but we will do it in a microfluidic chip using a 3D printing technique. So what we do, we use a 3D printer. If you don't have a 3D printer, you can do the same simply by buying it on internet. You build two blocks that are this way. And basically, these two blocks, they are created separately, and they are simply overlap. And then we will put PDMS. So PDMS, it's a polydimethyl siloxane. It's a polymer that is liquid and that become solid when you cure it. And in fact, at the end, what you can produce its 3D structure this way when you have two channels that are overlapped and in this, like that. And we will create the bilayer exactly here at the junction between these two channels. So PDMS advantage is that it's transparent optically, electrically it's insulating, and it has a very low fluorescent background, so it can be very used. Its only problem, it has some problem that I will not detail. And so the big advantage with this technique is that you can put electrode, even here that will not be very useful for what we will do. So, but basically you can put electrode to scan the electric property of your bilayer, which is useful if you have ion channel, for example. And you can also use optics to see what is happening. So I will form a bilayer now this way. So this is a moving live to show you it's done. So here, this is our bilayer, okay? Enfin, this is our microfluidic chip. And I will produce a bilayer. So first, there is nothing, it's just air. I will inject a colored material. It's the oil plus fluorescent phospholipid, okay? So this is done automatically by micro pumps. So you see this little colored liquid, it's the oil plus the phospholipid. We do the same bottom. As you can see, the two phase can go without interacting with each other. And then we have a liquid here that has no color, transparent, it's simply water, okay? And this is real time. So here we have done our block, and at the junction, what we have a kind of oil sandwich. So there is a little of remaining oil that stay here. And this is the oil sandwich, we call that the oil sandwich, that contain a water oil interface covered with phospholipid and another water oil interface covered with phospholipid. So by fluorescence, the same movie, but with fluorescence, so same at the beginning, it's there is already the oil plus phospholipid. And here we inject the buffer. Yeah, you can see that there is a tiny fluorescent oil sandwich that stay here after the buffer phase come. Yeah. So, and this, at this point, you don't have a bilayer, but in fact, the advantage of using PDMS is that PDMS, it's a porous polymer. So what he does, he loves oil, it's hydrophobic. So what he does, he will drain spontaneously your oil phase. And while he's draining that, automatically you will have a bilayer. You will create a bilayer by putting the two interfaces together. So from the in bright field, if you look at that, that's the same, but from a top view in bright field, you can see that if you wait, so it's a long process, but if you wait, you see that at a tiny point, something like a dark ring, bright ring is appearing spontaneously at one point, and then it grows. And this is your bilayer that grows and expands, and then it is blocked. It stays here, and it can be alive for a few hours. And if you use electrophysiology, so that means if you have put electrode in the water phase and you dissolve some salt into your buffer phase, you can scan the capacitance of this system. And you can see, because here, as the bilayer, don't let the charge pass, it's equivalent to a planar dielectric, you can see that the capacitance simultaneously rise to a point here when the hammer, and then it grows until it reaches a plateau. And it's because it's equivalent to simply dielectric. So that demonstrates that you have formed a bilayer. And this bilayer, it's stable with time. So, and then the first thing that we can do when we have formed this bilayer, so this is a bilayer. So it's about the total diameter, it's 200 micron here. We can perform experiment. So basically, we will bleach. We will apply the very strong laser pulse on a localized region, and we will see the intensity recovery coming from the other part that are unbleached. And from that, we can estimate using the Sumpazis fit. We can estimate the diffusion constant of the phospholipid, and we see that we have a diffusion constant of 10 microns square by second. that say that our bilayer is fluid. We can also do that by putting some protein that are fluorescing, and by bleaching the protein, we can see also that this protein here, it's transmembrane protein from the SNARE family, and they are moving at a few micron square by second, which is very fluid. This is what is expected. And also what is interesting is that if we put a protein like synuclein, so it's a protein responsible of disease, it completely rigidifies the bilayer and you lost all the fluidity. So it's interesting because we see that our bilayer is fluid and the fluidity is extremely similar to results on GOV or on sponge phase. So the bilayer that we create has a very high fluidity. And what is nice also is that you can really play with the lipid composition. You can use very, very complex mixture. The only thing is that if you use pure PC, your stability is weak. It say only last 20 minutes. But if you use a PE, as long as you put some PE with a descent ratio, so a mixture of PC and PE, which is PC, it's a cylindrical lipid, and PE, it's a conical lipid. Whatever, without going into detail, in fact, in that case, you can have a stability of bilayer of a few hours. And the big advantage of this system is that it's completely automatized, and you have a success rate of nearly 100%. So that means you do it, you wait, and the bilayer appears. The disadvantage is that you have to wait 2 hours to do that the bilayer spontaneously appears. But besides this, this is a system that is very interesting. That was done with the group of Rotman in Yale and Fred Prince in Paris. So what we will do here now, we have tried our bilayer. We have created our bilayer. What we will do now, we will disperse above, enfin, around our bilayer some microplastic that here that are fluorescent polystyrene, microplastic of 1 second. So here we did a bilayer that is truly giant. It's a il y a several millimeters, and we disperse the microplastic on one side of the bilayer. Like that, we can localize where there is the bilayer, because there is a part where it is fluorescing, a part where it's not fluorescing. If you put plastic everywhere, it's difficult to catch him, even if the bilayer is made fluorescent with another dye. So we put it only in one side, and we put on the side where there is no sedimentation. So depending on the material, we want to avoid any sedimentation, because the theory is without sedimentation. So here we have little beads that are moving, but it's pretty difficult to see from this scale. But we can increase the magnification. And here it's the same movie exactly, but this time I just virtually invert the color. So I say the color are black. So like that, we see them. And what we see is that we are really at the position of the bilayer, of the freestanding bilayer. We are really on the position, and we see that there is a particle that are in focus. And if we move a little bit the focal plane, you lost everything. You don't see them anymore. You go back to the bilayer, you see some particles that are moving. What is interesting is that they don't stop move. They move, they don't stop to move, and they diffuse continuously on the bilayer surface. Okay. So then we can, so this, it's it was 1 micron polystyrene fluorescent particle. We can also use bigger microplastic. Here it's PMMA, 8 microns. So they move also, but they diffuse also, but they are bigger. Here the film is much slower. In fact, the film is much longer. It's not the real time. And in fact, you can see that there is a kind of hydrodynamic flow, but it's also due to the fact that the bilayer can move a little bit as it is freestanding. It can move a little bit this way. Yeah. No, we inject them with the buffer phase, in fact. So that's it. In fact, first, we produce the bilayer as I show. And then when the bilayer is produced, you can change the phase freely using microfluidic pump without any problem. You can inject what you want, where you want, without disturbing the bilayer. Yeah, but here we just put on one side. Because if, like that, there are, for example, here, because if you put fluorescent beads in both sides, it's very difficult to see the interface. If you put in one side, they magically reflect in the middle of somewhere, you see. because the difficulty is to see where the barrier is, in fact. No, it's just diffusion. It's really at 1 micron, they can move by diffusion. And they do not, we put them in the side where they do not feel the gravity. So they are not, so if they're lighter and they go up, we put them in the opposite direction. We want to avoid the sedimentation. Yeah, don't hesitate to interrupt me if it would be better. So we put the particulier. And the point that is interesting is that, as I say, they continuously diffuse. They don't stop to move. And if we, so here we use a Python algorithm, which is the library called PyTrack, which is used also by Howard Stone in Harvard. And in fact, from that, we extract the particle trajectory. And from it, the big advantage of doing that is that we can measure the surface fraction of the particle present on the membrane. So we can know, even for a defined concentration in bulk, we know exactly how many particles I have for a certain size into my membrane. Yes? Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. In fact, here they are. In fact, it's here they are. Indeed, they are here and they are dispersed with. Naturally, they are made with surfactant. But there is some species of microfluidic in the ocean that are also with that. So it's not valid for every microplastic in the ocean. Indeed, here the one that we use are purely hydrophilic, and they are totally soluble. But in fact, we have Boyle sum without surfactant also. And we saw that we have nearly the same results. So we did the both. We have some that have a chemical treatment that makes them hydrophilic and some that are with a surfactant. So in fact, that we don't see a magic difference. But of course, yes, this is a question that we also think. But I didn't want to enter this point. Yeah, yeah. So, but you can buy them with, it's what you have done. We have buy them with a surface treatment that makes them hydrophilic. And that case, you don't have to mind about the surfactant. But so in fact, here, the big advantage of the method is that as we know exactly, yes, the surface coverage as a function of the concentration. So on the present on the bilayer. And we can also know that they are dispersed because we measure a diffusion coefficient from the analysis of the Brownian motion. We can see that they move freely because it follows a Brownian motion. And we know the diameter from this slope. We know the diameter of the beads that we use. And we know they are a single bead present on. So we know how much they are. And what we do, it's put that in the wrong here. In fact, yeah. And one slide is missing. In fact, what we do in parallel is that we measure the tension of the bilayer using the Young-Dupré equation. So that means what we do. In fact, we use in parallel the deep experiment, so experiments with the two droplets. And we put the two droplets with microparticles in contact. So we do that. And here you see you have a contact angle. And in fact, this is the equation that is missing. But from this contact angle, and if you know the surface tension of the oil-water interface, you can measure the tension of the bilayer. So we know the tension. We know the tension as a function of the surface coverage. And then we can compare. Here with the continuous line, that's the theory of Vladimir. And here with the data point, we can measure the tension of the bilayer as a function of the microplastic. Here it's simply the tension as a function of microplastic that is obtained from the Young-Dupré equation. And here in the theory, this is calculated for the surface coverage area measured directly on the bilayer. And with an estimation of the adhesion energy that each microplastic does on a lipid membrane from literature and other, it was studied a lot by literature, but nevertheless, there is some range. And what we see is that more you put microplastic, more the tension of your bilayer increase. So just as there is absolutely nothing else than physical interaction here, we can think that there is really a mechanical stress that each microplastic apply and make this bilayer stretch. So that there is an increase of the bilayer tension as a function of the microplastic concentration. Yes?
So you put the microplastic in this droplets from which you measure the
quantum thing. Yes.
But then this also renormalizes the surface tension of the water.
But this we have it also. We measure it as a function of the concentration. Okay. So we have it for all. So we have all.
And then there is this funny like toroid of lipid.
Yes.
Of oil.
Yeah. Yes. Yes. So, not sure that I will reply to your question, but when we use the water ponant drop method to measure the surface tension, we measure the surface tension at the water-oil interface in presence of phospholipid and in presence of plastic for all the concentration. So here we just measure the contact angle and using both, you know, the membrane tension at every point. Yeah. Now they diffuse. They could go away. Yes, they can go away. You can see that they go away after our size. If you track some, they go away some. No, no, it's a simplistic. I disperse them. Some will be on the bilayer, a certain number that give an equilibrium surface coverage. But there is always an exchange. They can absorb and desorb. The wrapping is low, yes.
How much are they?
You don't know. You don't know. In fact, it's something that we want to measure later using a technique complicated. It's not complicated, but it's hard to get the 3D estimation of that, but it can be measured maybe using something called digital holographic. Or using a high resolution confocal scan, but I don't think it's really, I think it's hard to.
It could be an interaction between the head, then, and the
logical
because of the.
Yeah.
It's not
They stay, this is a reversible adhesion. This is a reversible adhesion. So there is a certain number that stay on your bilayer, they stay a certain time because you can extract the bilayer tension. Nevertheless, after a certain time, they have the tendency to leave. Yeah? Of the absorption, desorption? No. But in fact, what I can say, it's pretty long because we could record a very long trajectory. Yeah. This is a point that we want to combine with digital holographic. We want to, it's a technique that allows to measure tiny distance in the Z axis. And we want to see how much they, like that, we will see here you have this partial wrapping as a kind of relaxation, a little similar to weighting relaxation between two liquid, like in a Young contact angle. And in fact, what we want to see is the relaxation at this interface. I think it's we can do it using this type of. Here it's. It's here. Yeah, it's experimental, this one. Yeah, it's directly from the fluorescent. It's very active. It's nice because normally people are. So here, what we did, in fact, is that we show that there is more tension, and so I will go fast. So we do a lot of the advantage using this DIB. This technique is that you can do tons of them in little pillar, and you can really do very quickly a lot of this plastic. So, for example, here I increase. I can create several cylinders like that. It's filled with all its phospholipid. Here I have my plastic. You see the particular green here. So we can see the droplets are there. And we can measure the how long they take to break, because they have a time of breaking that is dependent on their tension. It is very characterized. And in fact, what we can see is that the tension that we measure, it's exactly fitting the breaking rate that we observe. And we see that more we put plastic. Why you don't? Oh. Sorry. We, in fact, we wait 40 minutes before measuring anything. We put the bilayer, we send the plastic, and then we wait 40 minutes. And then we measure. How long it takes to take the equilibrium, we think not so fast. We suppose it normally it should be fast. It should. Yes, yes, that's true. In fact, in general, it's fast. Yeah, I'm sorry. I don't know why he's. Oh no, I have to put again the. Here. Okay, I'm sorry. So, and what we have done, in fact, to go fast because it's already 47 minutes. So, what we have done after is that we repeat the same, but we put red blood cell. So here it's a red blood cell with microplastic. We have a micropipette, and there is all the system from around and events. And what we do a micro, we apply the tension with the micropipette, and we look to the lysis time. Okay, I'm not able to put it in full screen. I will not try to fight it. So here I put the red blood cell in an isotopic condition. So that means they are completely spherical. So I play with the osmotic pressure to put them totally spherical. We put them into a micropipette, and so we will not access the movie here. And in fact, we can see to their lysis time in presence of for the tension, the micropipette apply the tension, control the tension on the red blood cell. And of course, as you want to don't have any problem with geometry, that's why you put them totally spherical, playing with the osmotic pressure. And then you see that the lysis time, they lyse quickly in presence of plastic, that if there is no plastic, confirming that red blood cell also inflammate and are destabilized quicker in presence of plastic. And red blood cell, basically, they have, I mean, they don't do endocytosis. They have no complex interaction between the red blood cell membrane and the plastic. So you can expect that they are really like a soft capsule that you can really neglect any kind of biological pathway. So we think it's really a proof that first from the lipid membrane, there is always, we can have discussion on the model because it's always a model, it's always oversimplistic. But what we see is that when you put particle on a freestanding bilayer, this freestanding tension increase, the destabilization increase because it break, is breaking more quickly. And if we do it also with red blood cell, we say that the lysis time is shorter with the concentration of plastic. And this has been reproduced by three other groups independent of people working really from the medical. They even see worse than us, in fact. But they reproduce the same. They see also that the plastic increase the lysis time and create an inflammation of the cell. So the question that we had at the beginning, as I told you, so this is the end. What I wanted to show you to say is that At the beginning, I told you if there is a mechanical stress, normally we should expect nothing because we should see a relaxation. What we see is that if you wait a very, very, because as the membrane is fluid, this stress should relax with time, and at the end, it should disappear. What we see is that if we put a freestanding membrane and we put particle and we wait really 8-9 hours, we see that this effect of tension is coming back to the normal slowly. But this equilibration seems to be very, very small. And what we think is that the reason why this stress is kind of permanently applied, it's because it's very intuitive. Huh? It's just due to this diffusion. We suppose that the fact that the particles are constantly moving make that they could never equilibrate their wrapping. And an argument that I can give to support this bold statement, it's a Nature material published 10 years ago from Mandavan. And when he studied the Young contact angle relaxation time of microsphere between the oil and water interface. So he has a B-phase, he put these beads, and he really follow how long they take to equilibrate. And as they diffuse, you see that they take months to equilibrate. And he published that in a Nature material. So it's something, the origin of why the mechanical stress is, the physical origin of this mechanical stress is unclear. And we just have this very bold statement. And what we want to do, it's a little what Thierry proposed. We want to look to the long time scale behavior. And we want to look using eye. So this is a microscope that we are building. It's not yet finished to be built. This digital holographic, because it's a method where you can measure really with a submicronic, with a resolution of 10 nanometer, 100 nanometer, really what's happened at this contact line. And we want to see how long it takes to equilibrate. So, and we want to see if it really the origin of this mechanical interaction is due to this. Voilà.